All right, well, let's get started into another episode of Kicking Tables. We have been away a while, but here we are. Andrew reached out. Andrew, welcome back. It's a pleasure seeing you again. I think last time we talked to you was 2020 for Regions of Infinity. You know, I'm not sure if 2020 actually happened now that we're through it, so that could have been a dream. I'm not sure, but here we are. Forcing us out of semi-retirement. I don't know if that's what it was.
It's a pleasure.
But Andrew, you've got a new game coming out called Skal, which is quite different than the other games you've developed. So give us an overview. What is Skal?
Right. The idea of Skal, it's basically a Viking dice-stacking dexterity game, which can be a drinking game if you want, but doesn't have to be. So the idea is...
Why wouldn't you make it a drinking game? Come on.
Well... I wanted to make a game that would appeal to everybody, whether it was a fun family game or adults-only rowdy drinking game. So no one can say this game isn't for them, basically.
Gotcha. Excellent.
Yeah. So the idea basically is you are playing as a Norse Viking god or goddess. So you could be Thor or maybe Loki or Freya or Odin. You get the idea. So you choose a Viking god or goddess. You then have a handful of beautiful colored dice. And also, there are some black dice in the middle, which in the Kickstarter, you can upgrade to rune dice.
Ooh, fantastic.
So, the idea then is that there's a stack of cards in front of you, and you draw a card each turn. The card is going to show a pattern of dice that you basically need to stack up with your own dice and the shared dice to match. You then have your cup in front of you, which you raise and call out, Skal, which means cheers in Norwegian. If you do that first, you win the card. If you win enough cards, you win the game. It's that easy.
And when do you take a drink?
Well, that's up to you to your players to agree. It could be basically like whoever wins takes a drink or every other loser takes a drink. It's entirely what you want to do.
I think the losers need to take a drink.
Yeah, and it doesn't have to be played with alcohol.
I think everybody
can play totally alcohol-free and have a great time.
That's true.
So let me ask you this. Which came first, the theme of the Vikings or the concept of the game, or did they sort of come together at the same time?
It definitely, I think it stemmed from the theme, really, because I've basically known and loved Vikings virtually my whole life. Not only when I'm doing my day job, which is a teacher, my favorite topic to teach is the Vikings, hands down. And I just finished teaching it 5 years in a row when I was designing the game. And I actually went to my head teacher and said, look, I love Vikings, but I need to take a break. So I still love Vikings.
Oh, yes, of course.
So they swapped me on to teaching like Stone Age or something instead, which was still fun and wild. But then my brain started going, I miss Vikings. So it came up with a Viking game.
Awesome. So I understand, it's a dice stacking game. So you need to be dexterous and you need to be quick. Because if I'm not mistaken, some of those shapes you have to do, actually, you have to have a specific number facing forward as well. Is that correct?
Yeah, the idea is basically this game has for a little fun game, it's actually got a surprising amount of depth, because if you want to keep things completely simple, you basically just have one card, which you stack and grab the dice and pile it up, and that's it. So you might think whoever's got fastest fingers will always win. Well, you'd think that, but it's not always true. So I wanted to give a bit more options. So you might basically have to have a card where all certain faces have to be outwards. Like for this one, it's a Loki card. All the number twos have got to be facing out to the opposite players. So all of a sudden, you're having to think about the cards. So it's not just whoever's fastest, but who can ever kind of basically have a strategy to win. There's even cards where you basically have to close your eyes and stack them blind.
Oh, okay. What other challenges are available? You have optional challenges as well in this game.
Well, I do, because basically tying into the idea of Norse mythology, depending how well you know the Viking gods and goddesses, there was the Viking god Tyr who lost a hand. So when it's your turn to basically draw the card, you can call for a challenge of Tyr, which means everybody's got to put one arm behind their back, which makes a dexterity game all of a sudden a lot more complicated. You can also do things like everybody's got to close an eye, so your depth perception is gone as well.
Oh, man. Can you specify which hand? Because if somebody's left-handed, you want them to use their right hand.
If it's your turn to basically make the call, you can say everyone close their right eye or everyone put the left hand behind the back.
Excellent. Man, that would...
So strategies for this game, like you've got to be able to strategize in any board game. Strategies. I mean, I have these big chunky fat fingers, so I am horrible at these tiny little Is there a jumbo version that you can get jumbo Jenga? Is there like a jumbo version of the game with giant dice?
Well, when I was playtesting this, I actually went through a few different dice and I thought I want it to be comfortable for everybody. So I started off with 12 mil dice and thought, no. So all the dice are 16 mil, which I've basically worked out is big enough so it's comfortable, but small enough so you can basically get nearly 50 dice in a box without too much trouble. So that was kind of the optimum size. And I've gone for basically ones with slightly rounded corners, so it's more comfortable to hold as well. There's lots of strategy you can put in there. For example, it's things like, as gamers, we know that the opposite sides of a dice add up to 7.
That's right.
So if you're trying to find a 5 and you've got a 2, it's just, oh, it's 2. There's also a nice strategy, Whiskey, if you're grabbing black dice in the middle and you need, for example, a 2, you just look for whichever dice has got a 2 facing upwards and you grab that dice.
Of course.
So you can think your way around it.
Are any of the challenges, I noticed that the cards you've shown always have the same symbol. Are there any that mix the symbols up? So that multiples. So you actually have to look. Each one is different, for example. Is that? Yeah, there
this
we
card
go.
Was
okay.
3 points.
Okay.
Yeah, that's not just dexterity, but that's paying attention to the symbols and what number it is.
Oh, it really is.
Because your dice that you're using are regular dice with the pips.
Yeah. In terms of the basic game, they're basically normal spot dice. However, in terms of what people wanted, I definitely said that I wanted people to be able to make the game their own, and everyone loves custom dice. So I basically said that in the actual real version of the game, you can either order it with a spot dice if you want to keep things simple, or you can upgrade to basically engraved rune dice. So these are the different runes in the game.
Right.
So what you basically have is your black dice will then be replaced with those faces on the faces of the black dice.
But just the black dice, not the colored ones.
That's the idea, at least, because basically, I've said I can work this into things like stretch goals. So at the moment, we're taking it to Kickstarter. If things go well, people have the option of upgrading the dice. If things go seriously well, we might just basically replace all the dice if that's what people want.
Okay.
Oh, that's fantastic. That would be amazing. All rune dice? Because, I mean, then it's so unique. Like, what gamer doesn't like custom dice? Like, let's be serious.
Exactly.
Every gamer loves a good custom dice.
Something that sort of makes it... When you find that die, when you've dropped one on the floor and you find it 3 weeks later, it's like, I know what box this goes back to.
That's right.
You get custom die, you know exactly where you got to put
Especially if Tico's playing the game and his fat fingers knock all the dice off the table and then he just flips the table. And
It's happened. Yeah. It's happened.
If you're anything like me, whenever you go to a convention, I go to the AirCon and the UK Gaming Expo, I always find the dice table. And I always basically try and buy a whole lot of custom dice. So in this game, you basically get a whole fistful of custom dice.
Yeah.
So brilliant.
That's excellent. So let's talk about your campaign a little bit. You mentioned, a couple of the possible stretch goals. Do you have any stretch goals that are currently planned out? Is there anything that you can tease for us?
Well, the main things that I want to make sure of, and obviously our first goal is to fund, obviously.
Yes.
If that all goes well, the first step I want to do is basically make sure that the game, the actual component quality is made even better. So it's things like adding linen finish to the cards, maybe looking to plasticizing them. Obviously, it can be a drinking game. We want to make this as future-proof as possible. One of the other options we've got for a deluxe pledge is instead of basically having the card stock player mats, you can upgrade them to neoprene mats instead.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So that'll help with the spillage, for sure.
Exactly, yeah. So if we basically hit some amazing stretch goals, we could basically have plastic versions of all the cards. That would be quite a deluxe option, but we'll basically see how people respond to the love of the game. So basically, the first thing is to basically get the best quality product we can get in front of people, and anything we can improve and tweak, we can improve and tweak. If things go seriously well, we can start adding even more content to the game, more player options, more strategy, that kind of thing.
That's fantastic. I got to know, though, as you were playtesting this, how many times did you playtest it as a drinking game?
My favorite, as I think before, my favorite ones that worked well were basically when we each had a massive, gigantic bottle of our favorite beer and we're pouring out shots each time into the glasses.
Okay.
When we tried playing it with spirit, things got very silly very fast.
Okay, so what was the best and worst dexterity challenge you had to do in those cases?
As I said, the ones where you're basically stacking the dice blind, makes it very, very silly, because not only are you trying to not knock over glasses, but you're basically trying to reach and it's a bit of a whiff. Grab someone else's hand and you go, that's the dice.
Oh man, stacking blind, but then you got to have the right number facing forward. That's
on the blind stack. It's just whatever face you like.
You got to learn how to tell what number's on the front by feeling the die. I mean,
braille die.
Exactly. Yeah.
That's right. Last time we had you on the show, did we do the lightning round with you? I don't think we did.
Yes, you did.
Okay. So we have a new thing called the lightning round. We're going to ask you 8 really quick questions about you and your gaming habits. It's all gaming or game night related, and it's all about you outside of your own games. So let's say your own games cannot be any of your answers. How about that?
Okay.
Yeah. Cool. You ready for this?
Yes.
All right. Favorite game mechanic?
Worker placement.
Zombies or vampires?
Vampires.
Deck builder or deck constructor?
Deck builder, because we love Dominion at home.
And what was the last game you played?
The last game we played was Lord of the Rings Risk tonight, because I run a board game club at school, and I basically introduced them to a load more games.
Fantastic. What's your favorite childhood game?
My favorite childhood game is HeroQuest, definitely.
Excellent. Campaign or legacy?
Campaign, yes.
Nice. Science fiction or fantasy?
Fantasy, always.
And what's a game you love but you always lose?
Sheriff of Nottingham, because my children are really sneaky at playing it.
Excellent. Okay, Andrew, you know what? It's been such a pleasure seeing you on the show again. And Skal looks absolutely fantastic. Super fun. Give us your final thoughts on the game. What do you want people to really know about this game, and why should they back it?
I want people to know that it is a riot of good laughs. It is silly. It is quick. It is fun. It's brilliant as a filler game. The dice and the cups and all the things look excellent. So people will love looking at it. People are playing at it. If you walk past someone playing this game, you will stop and pay attention.
How many players is the game to begin with?
It can play with 1 to 6. There is a kind of a solo mode, which is kind of like a more of a beat your own score type of thing, but it plays up to 6 really, really well.
And I played the solo mode myself yesterday, just the drinking part of it.
Just solo. Perfect. Excellent. And of course, get more copies. You can have up to 12 or 18 or however many people you want. So it's perfect.
Get a whole pub full.
There you go. Andrew, thank you so much for coming back. Skal hits Kickstarter on October 11th. So everybody go check it out. It sounds fantastic. I know I want a copy. Andrew, thanks so much, and good luck with the campaign.
Thank you very much, guys. Best of luck. Thank you.
Thank you.
For a fantastic Viking dice stacking adventure, check out Skal on Kickstarter now. Thank you so much to OMG Nexus. Please subscribe using the button below for fun interviews and wonderful times. See you soon.